Welcome back to my channel, guys. I'm here in Mexico City with a guy working in my hotel here. It's a very nice hotel, and this guy actually, he's from Africa. As he entered my room, I was, okay, you're not Mexican, where you're from? And then we started to talk, and he told me about that he's from Ghana, from Kumasi. I've been to Ghana before. I traveled for 3 months on a motorbike through West Africa, so I know this place where he's from. So and he told me his story. Actually, he's on his way to Canada for a better future, and that's what I would like to talk to him right now. Like, you don't see him because, of course, you can understand. He still haven't reached his destination, so that's the reason why you cannot see him, and just for him to be safe. So Suleiman, tell me, how was life in Kumasi?
Okay, thank you for asking me those kind of things. I live in Kumasi for a while, and even that's the place that they give birth to me. In Kumasi, I live Kumasi when I grew up, and I complete school in Kumasi. The same thing that I was saying, and because of some circumstances and those kind of lack of work, lack of job, you can even finish school without getting any better job. So, the whilst you are growing, your parents are also growing. You can't even go there to have their access, like money to buy things and those kind of things. So you have to fight for your own. And as time is going on, those who are giving birth to them, they are also grown up because they demand money from their parents. So you too, whilst you grow up, you can't even go and demand money from your parents while the children are also demanding some things for your children. So it's just like the life just become comfortable.
So did I get it right? Like, your parents, they demand money from you. So your parents, they ask you to work and to... give them money. Did I get it right?
Yeah, because you have to work so that you're supposed to look after them. They know, so you are not supposed to relax with them. You should give you money because they're done for their own, and they are also weakened. So those who have been coming up, they are also demanding something from their parents. So you too, you don't come and sit at the front of your parents to come and give it to you whilst they are giving to their children. That's why we just decide ourselves that you have to live out so that you can even find our better future. When we get a better future, so that you can even come and help our parents.
Okay. So tell me, how you got here to Mexico? What was your trip so far?
Actually, it's very horrible. I take a flight from Kumasi to South Africa. I reached in South Africa, getting to 2 months when I was in South Africa, and I just connect the flight because I have a friend called Mr. Yao. He's the one helped me a lot from South Africa to Brazil. So because our passports, we have a free visa with the Ecuadorian. So we took a flight as a transit from Brazil to Peru to Ecuadorian. Okay. Yeah.
To Quito. So, and from Quito. So, at first you said you spent 2 months in South Africa. What did you do in South Africa? Why didn't you go directly, like, from Kumasi or Accra to South America? Why 2 months before in South Africa?
Actually, I stay in South Africa because I think myself that I'm going the place that I can even satisfy myself and get a better future, because South Africa is not the place that I can even get your future. Because I asked my friend, he also, because he was doing those kind of transit and those things, so he helped me a lot with the plane tickets. So he's the one helped me and take that flight from South Africa to Ecuadorian. That was Central American.
Okay, so many Africans, they tried to go to South Africa to get jobs, but as you said, it was very hard to get a job. And then, like, you decided, okay, so you went first to South Africa, you said, okay, I want to build a future in South Africa. And in South Africa, you realized, okay, it's very hard to build a future. And then you said, okay, I want to go to Canada. Did I get it right?
Yeah, it's true. Yeah, it's true.
And tell me, you arrived in Ecuador, and how did you continue?
Actually, I arrived in Ecuadorian with my that was a guy. He was staying in Ecuadorian, so he also helping those who are coming from Africa to stay with him, so that he can give him the more information about this route. You can pass this route from Ecuadorian to Mexico. So I stayed with him for the while, getting to that was a month. I stayed for a month. So he really loved me because the way I'd been respecting him and those things. So he was trying to me and him to go back to Bolivia to pass through border to Chile. But I take a flight for the first day to Bolivia. After I reach in Guayaquil, yeah. I took a plane from Quito to Guayaquil, and they arrested me. They said the visa is invalid. So after that, they entertaining me on the police station, many problems. Right now, they also call at the immigration of Bolivia that somebody take on a visa. This is the visa, this and that, this and that. Those, they ask them, they said, okay, this is the visa, this is the new visa that they issue. So it's not a fake visa. So from then, they just released me in the police station. After that, my flight, I lost a flight, so I couldn't even to take off. So I
didn't understand. You said you wanted to go to Bolivia and Chile. Like, why? Because you wanted to head north to Mexico. I cannot follow you.
Yeah, because I was saying that I reached in Ecuadorian. I was trying to stay in Ecuadorian to get a better future because I did not take my mind that I'm going to United States or I'm going to the Mexico. Okay. I take myself that when I reach in Ecuadorian, I can even get a work to do. After I reach that place, there is no work, there is no nothing, just sleeping and those kind of eating and sleeping. So I decided to tell the guy said, you should help me so that I can even go to even a Brazil or Argentina to go and find some work and do in that place. So after he took a visa from Bolivia for me, and that incident just happened to me.
Okay.
Yeah. So after I came back, I told him that, okay, now the visa have expiring, so I can't even take a flight again, and I'm also spending money. Instead of spending money, I will take the route of people that have been passing through here to Mexico.
You still saved money. You were still in Ecuador. You were still living off your savings.
Yeah, when I was in Ecuador, the guy just helped me with a little money to continue my journey. So he just gave it to me that the love I have for him and the respect I have for him, that he just helped me with the kind of money. Then I take that kind of route to here in Mexico. Yeah.
Okay. And tell me, how was your route from Ecuador to Mexico? Where did you go? What was your challenge? How long did it take? How many people were you with on your trip?
Actually, from Ecuador to Mexico is a very long story. It's a long story, it's a lot. Because that was since I came from Ecuadorian, passed to Colombia, across to Colombia. There was some place that you can even take a boat to cross a small river before you enter inside Colombia. That whole place called San Lorenzo. You would take a boat in that place to cross the river to enter Colombia. After you enter Colombia, if the police doesn't catch you, you are safe. But when the police catch you, they will send you back to where you come from. So we able to manage to pass in Colombia. Whilst I'm working in Colombia, I have a friend, he's also a Colombiana.
we are staying together in Ecuadorian. So he's the one helped me. We walk together in Colombia, then I take a bus from there to Turbo.
So the friends, sorry for interrupting, the friends in Ecuador and Colombia, they are from Africa as well, or where are they from?
He's a friend, he's a Colombiana, but okay. He was staying in Ecuador. I came and meet him in Ecuador, okay. So we become as a friends.
Okay.
So I told him that I want to cross. So he said, okay, it will help me because he have a lot of friends that he can even take me and cross me to that country because he is his country. So he know what the secret and what things is moving on and the routes that we can even pass that the police can never catch us. Mm. So he's the one helped me a lot. Then I even crossed to Colombia to Turbo. Mm. After we reached Turbo, the Panama border was closed. Panama border was closed, so we are many people, many Africans, Somalia, Cuba, a lot of people, Haitians. The Haiti is many people. The Haiti, they are in a heat of numbers. So we are there getting to two weeks, 3 weeks in Colombia. That was the place called Turbo. That was the, before you cross that place to Panama.
Okay.
Yeah. Because we were there, there is no way that you can even find a place to cross that Colombia to Panama. So we are there. So we talked to the immigration that they should help us, even if they can't even take us from the border town of the Panama, they should leave us some place that we can even pass through bush and we reach in the Panama City.
But how can you talk to the immigration? You said when they catch you, you get problems. Like, did you talk to them in person or who talked to the immigration?
Okay, in the immigration, when immigration catch you, because you don't have any document with you, they will ask you, what is your document? I don't have any document. So we came as an illegal. So they will make a document for you so that you can even cross to that country. Maybe they can give you 2 weeks to leave their country, or maybe 3 weeks or months to leave their country. So you're supposed to do that. So after they make a paper for us, they give us a speedboat to cross that water, that river. And I say, it's not water, river. To cross to Panama. So we're able to cross. It's very terrible because when you're inside the river, you can't see your back, you can't see the forward. You only see the cloud.
Mm. Okay.
It's very dark. Like, we take a risk. It's not easy. So after we cross to the territory of the Panama, we get some people, they are calling them Cayuta. Those people, they are just like they are a farmer. Mm. They are farming in the bush, so they know the routes that you can even pass through the bush to Panama. So when you reach there, they can even collect money from you. Maybe each person will pay $50.
Okay. I read the area between Panama and Colombia. It's very it's very dense jungle. There are many criminals, many drug traffickers. Of course, I wouldn't call drug trafficker criminals, but they're like rebels fighting the government, and it's kind of dangerous to pass this area. Like, I've been to Colombia as well, and I wanted to go to Panama and got the information. I just saw, okay, it's dense jungle. It's very, very dangerous to go through this jungle. Many Americans, many foreigners had been kidnapped, and I think the farmers, because the jungle is very dangerous, you needed the help of the farmers.
Yeah, it's true. Mm. Because it's very dangerous, and killing people, kidnap people, they can kidnap you unless you brought money before they release you. At times you can even get some good man that can even help you or bring money so that I can even help you to cross in that place. So that place is very terrible. It's very terrible because even if you are faster, that you can even walk faster with the demand, that you can even direct you to that place. Maybe you can take maybe 2 weeks before you leave inside a bush, inside that forest. Others have been taking a month. I've been taking more than 1 month to cross that bush to Panama City. It's very terrible. Even whilst we are coming, we lost our friend. The water just took him away. We lost him. He died. So we're not able to save him. And whilst we are coming, many people are dying inside the water. Others having children, others having pregnant women. Many people. So a few of people that can even survive. None of them, some of them can even lost their life because there is no food, there is no nothing. The water that's just crossing, you can even run it inside the water, the same water that will drink it again. People be dying inside the water, the same water that you drink it, because you don't have an option, you don't have anything to do.
So you were drinking the water from the rivers where like many people die, because like they die because of currents, or because like there's a strong current, or why is it so dangerous, this water?
Because people will die because there is no, you can even walk getting to a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, your food has been finished, you don't have anything. Someone doesn't have a strength, a heart, that can even walk, that the person can even give him a dead. Others can even catch him like a wild animal, can even take him away. Because even whilst we are walking inside the bush, I see a wild animal. But we are on the down, they are on the top.
What kinds of wild animals?
Lion, those kind of things. Many wild animals. Many wild animals. Because the place that we are sleeping the night, we have been hearing a lion shouting at the top of there, because it's very mountain, it's a big mountain. It's a big mountain. We are hearing it. So after in the morning, we are just praying for God to release us inside that place. So after we just go, people will be there. You can even walk. You can't walk maybe 1 hour, 2 hours. You see a blood, somebody's head, those things. It's not easy. It's not easy. It's very terrible.
So they slipped, or why were the blood?
Is it?
Why, like you saw, you said there was blood, like they slipped away and they hit their head, or what happened?
Yeah, you can see the bone, the human being bone, blood, every place, like what animal just come and destroy him, just killing him from the wild animal and those kind of things. So it's very terrible. So after that, we're able to cross in the bush of Panama, before we get to Panama City, we take getting to 2 months, 2 weeks, 2 weeks, then 3 weeks that we can even reach to Panama City.
So how long you didn't eat as you were in the jungle on the strip?
Because our food has finished.
Okay.
Like I was saying to you, the water, people dying inside, people like rolling it inside, giving taking shit and those kind of things. This is the water that we are drinking it, because we don't have an option. So if you do not drink it, you can even not survive to continue your journey.
How big was your group in the jungle? Like you stick with how many friends?
Actually, my group that we are working to, we are getting to about 60 something.
60 people?
60 something.
Such a big group. All Africans, all over Africa.
Africans, Cubans, Central American, that was 80.
Okay.
Like we mix.
Okay.
It's just like everybody have his own group that they are working together.
Okay.
Yeah, you can even work and come and meet the other groups so that you can even work together. You can even separate everybody, be passing his own routes.
Okay.
Yeah.
And continue like as you were in Panama City?
Continue with the Panama City. We get in Panama City and we take ourselves to immigration, because we came on illegal. Immigration catch us, make an paper documents to leave their country. They give us maybe 1 week or 2 weeks to leave their country. So after we take a bus, because from Panama, from Panama to Costa Rica is not heavy, it's not difficult because you take a bus to Costa Rica up to Nicaragua. But from
and there you still had saving for the bus?
Yeah, it's very safe because
You still had the money for the bus?
Actually, because it's very difficult. Robbers can even attack you inside a bush. So we can take the money to put inside the anus.
Okay.
Yeah. This is the place that we are putting the money, inside the anus, so that they can even know where you put your money.
Oh my God, okay. So, sorry for the interruption. You went from Costa Rica and Honduras, and you took a bus to Mexico.
It's another journey. Yeah. After Colombia to Panama, that one is different. Okay. But from Costa Rica to Honduras, it's also a problem.
Also, okay.
Yeah. Because we reach in Costa Rica, getting the 6 months. We are in Costa Rica because we went. Then armed robbers catch us. They collect everything. Police, Nicaragua police, soldiers, they collect everything of us. They are like armed robbers. They are like robbers, let me see. That's the people of that country, they are also robbing. And the policemen, the soldiers, they are also robbing again. They can even catch you when they catch you. Instead of you, if they take your things, they can leave you to go, but they won't. They also turn you back to Costa Rica because they have a problem between Costa Rica and Nicaragua because of the place that they collect the place to, they give it to Costa Rica. So it's just like there is misunderstanding between Nicaragua and Costa Rica. So they take that annoying, just giving we immigrant that we are passing through the place to another country, another continent. So we just like we only stay in the Costa Rica because there is no way that you can even cross to Nicaragua to Honduras. It's very difficult. So we try, me and my brother, we try for the 2 times. They send us back to Costa Rica again. We try many, many times. They send us back to Costa Rica. The last one we go, they leave us in the bush.
Actually, there's a fence or wall, or can you not just like go through the bush or like swim through a river, or how does the border look like?
There was no fence wall, but it was bush and passing through the river. The river that you can even pass, the way I'm tall, the river is my here, my neck.
Okay.
Before I can even cross inside the river. When I cross, before I can even cross the Nicaragua. If you're not able to cross that river, you can't even cross to Nicaragua. It's very terrible. People dying and people, it's not easy. So we can even walk by 8 o'clock in the evening. We walk on the streets where we see the police. We hide ourselves. We are walking from rivers, that was Nicaragua, from rivers to Ochumogu, that checking point. After checking point, before you cross the checking point, you can cross the river. That was the river that I was saying about, that you get my neck. When you cross that river, before you can even take a bus to a city, that city called Managua, before you take we're connecting a bus to the border town of Honduras. But when you are in Nicaragua border town to Honduras, when the Nicaragua just catch you, they will send you back to Costa Rica within 1 hour or 2 hours. You will see in Costa Rica after a few days that you take it to that place, maybe 1 week or 2 weeks that you take it to that place to border town, only a day, by morning to evening, you will see in Costa Rica. So you can even walk from evening around 8 p.m. We walk until morning by 4 to 5 a.m. So that you can go and sleep inside the bush. The rest of the day we sleep inside the bush. At the evening by 8, we also start to walk. That's where we able to manage until we able to cross to Nicaragua. Even when we are coming, we are 10 in numbers, we separate. Three, two separate of us, we eight, we are also walking, and the three also separate, and we are left to six. After six that we are walking to, we reach Ochumogo, and three separate, then like everybody is fighting for his own, that he can even survive for now. Everybody is fighting for his own, until we reach Honduras. But after we reach Honduras, there is no problem. Honduras, they are good. They are good people.
Honduras City is called one of the most dangerous cities in the world. But you say Honduras is like good people in Honduras.
It depends. Okay. It depends how you are, because you are just coming to pass. But what the Nicaragua people was doing is just like he make Honduras people be hungry of what Nicaragua people was doing. So when you are coming, they are always laughing at you for you to come to their city, because they love you to come to their city. You're able to cross that place to another place. Yeah. Because we are not staying there, Honduras. We are just coming to pass. So it's not any problem for them.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, and then from Honduras, Guatemala, and Mexico.
Yeah, from Honduras, Guatemala, from Guatemala to Mexico.
It was easy, this trip.
It's easy, but it's not easy. But that place is so easy. Okay. Let me say that it's not easy, because from Nicaragua, Panama, this is the place that is a very difficult journey that I've seen. Even this is the place that I get this mark, all of this mark of my body.
What happened?
We was trying to cross bad wire.
You tried to cross, sorry?
Bad wire. Bad wire in Nicaragua.
Okay, that's a city, bad wire.
In the bush.
As a bush, okay.
Because when you are going, they will cross bad wire, because the territory, like this is the territory of this man, this is the territory of Nicaragua, and this is the territory of the Honduras, and this yeah. So before you cross bad wire, before you can even enter Honduras. So I was trying to cross, it was the rain, and the thing just pushed me. Then it just flogged me.
Of course, in the jungle between Panama and Colombia was the worst part of your route, right?
Yeah.
And after this, of course, there wasn't jungle anymore. There were like cities. Where did you eat? Like, you went to a restaurant and you pay for it, or did locals help you, or how did you eat?
Because when we cross to Colombia to Panama, that we reach in Costa Rica, even I seek a lot. They put full blood, two blood of my body, and three water of my body. This my brother take care of me, because me, I think I will die. Because
Say it again, like this mark, like you hurt yourself so bad that you lost a lot of blood.
A lot of blood.
Okay. Now I got it. I thought it was just a small injury.
No.
So, but you went to hospital with this?
Yeah, I went to hospital in Costa Rica.
Okay.
This is my brother. He's the one, he's the evidence of it. He's the one who took me to hospital.
Okay. And you had to pay a lot of money in hospital, or?
No, because Costa Rica, they are helping people. Because they know what we are passing through and those kind of things. So it's very difficult for us to give money or something like that. So they give us some document that you can even go to hospital without paying anything.
Okay, nice. How many days did you spend in hospital?
Actually, getting to a week in the hospital.
Okay.
Yeah, getting to a week in the hospital, because I can even get healthy maybe 4 days to 5 days time, then I will start my body's hurting, scraping.
Okay.
Then I also take me to hospital. Okay. One day in the night around 11 to 12, this is my brother, he's the one called ambulance, because I think I will die.
Okay.
He's the one called ambulance, just took me to hospital in that very night.
So, and now you arrived to Mexico City. Since when have you been here to Mexico City?
actually I reach in I when I get in Mexico City, getting to 7 months now. That was
7 months ago, and you were just here to wait for your papers to cross to America, or you are here to save up money, or why do you spend so much time here in Mexico City?
Okay, actually, because I'm here to, you know, you don't know where the place that you can get your future or something like that. If it's America, and that by now I'm able to reach in America for a long time. Mm-hmm. But since I get here in Mexico, I really love the appearance of this city and those kind of things. So I able to say, no, let me stay here for the while to get the access and documents and those things. So for the future, if I try to go to America, America is beside of me. I can even go to America.
So you try to get documents for America here, or what kind of documents you try to get here?
I want to get a Mexico document to stay in Mexico.
Ah, okay.
Yeah.
And at we met the first time, you told me, like, here in Mexico the police is very nice. Like in other countries you have to hide all the time from the police, but here you can work without papers. Like you can walk down the street and you don't have to hide.
Yeah, actually it's the number one that I really love, especially Central American. For example, as a Mexican, the police people, they are respecting foreigners. Mm. They are respecting foreigners, and they are also loving people. Mm. Like, it's not all of us that we have a document. Mm. But the police, if you don't have a document, you can even walk any place that you're supposed to go. The police doesn't ask you anything. Mm. But when you are going some place that is very dangerous, the police will call you, this is the place that you're going. You have to avoid. It's not good for you to go in that place. So just like I really love the Mexican police and those kind of security that they are protecting foreigners and those things. Yeah.
Okay. So since when do you work in this hotel?
Pardon?
Since when do you work in this hotel?
Actually, I work here in a hotel close to 4 months now.
4 months.
Yeah.
Okay. Do you think you will move on soon to America? Are you gonna stay here? You haven't made up your mind yet.
Actually, it depends. For like I was saying, the language is very difficult for us to express ourselves. Like if you can do something, that the language can even and float you down for you to get the thing that you're supposed to need. Like for example, like if you get some better work, that you know that this kind of work you have a knowledge on it, you have that idea that you can even do that kind of job, but because of your language, they can't even pick you up. That's the thing that we are facing problem now. That's why we are always making our mind that we want to go to English country, now you can even express ourselves to build our better future day. Yeah.
Have you learned some Spanish, or is it too hard for you to learn Spanish?
Actually, nothing comes easy, but unless you make yourself that you will learn it. But we are still learning it. You are still learning it, but not easy.
Do you have some Mexican friends where you practice Spanish with, or maybe you have a Mexican girlfriend?
No, actually, for a girlfriend, I don't have any girlfriend in Mexico, and the friends too, we don't have any friend here in Mexico. The only friend that we have, just hi, how are you, just gone.
Okay.
Because we know what people we are, because you have to avoid yourself about violating those kind of things, because you don't know the friend that you're going to take that can even give you a bad name of you because you are not from this country, and the person that you take him as a friend, if it is bad, it's his country because you know what is going on, but you don't know anything. So when you are just following him, they won't blame him, but you are the one that you blame you. That's why we are always avoid ourselves for the friends.
I think I'm not at home here as well, but Yeah, of course. I think it's there. People are always nice. Like, we are all brothers and sisters. So you don't have to think, okay, just because they have a different nationality, I have to be careful if I should become friends with them. Just like be open and, be open, and then people will accept you, and they probably gonna be very interested in like African people, because like many Mexicans here in Mexico, I haven't seen. Of course, you see people from Haiti, you see people from Cuba, but otherwise you see barely black people here.
Yeah, it's true, because the black people, they are not many here in Mexico, actually. They are not many, because all the black people be passing through United States and those things, so they are not much used to black. So it's very difficult for them, like they'll hire you, oh, how are you, but like the way they will take you as a friend, unless maybe one of them that they like people, but not all of them. Yeah, not all of them. So we take our working place as our friend, and those who are working with together to be as our friends. But when you reach home, you don't have anything, just for sleeping.
So for you, it's more like, okay, I'm here temporarily, so why should I make friends when I'm leaving soon?
No, it's good for you to have a friend, but like that was saying, it depends. You can even take a friend that can even cross your neck. You can't do anything on it. You can even get a friend that the friends can even help you a lot. That's why always you have to pray, so that you can even get a better person that you can even match to your lifestyle. Yeah.
Are the people in the hotel nice to you?
Yeah, they are nice to me.
Okay, great. So, you said you want to go to Canada. Like, you have any certain place in mind? And you have any, like, what do you want to work in the future? Like, you studied engineering in Ghana. You want to become an engineer, or are you happy just to get a simple job in Canada? Or how does your perfect future looks like?
Actually, like I was saying, that I read engineering. When I get that job, I'll do it. And when I get some job that can even satisfy for me, I also do it. Whilst we are just disturbing our mind to go to Canada, though we don't have any help, we don't have the one that can help you to that place. But we are just here for that. Why we just make our mind that we want to stay here for the while. When we get an access, we can even apply for that place to go and get a better future. Because actually now, we are not mature, we are still young. So we want to be educated, further up of education, so that what achievement that we are doing, so that we can even further it more, so that we can even get a better position in future. Yeah.
Do you, like, for example, when you get a nice job in Canada and you can save up money, would you like to go back to Ghana?
Yeah, when I get a better work and better future in Canada, definitely I will send money to those who are growing up, and my families, my mother, they are always crying for me and those things. So I have to help them. That's the reason why I came out, and that's the reason why that we are suffering now, for them to get a better future, so that they can even they cannot always be crying and making tears and those things, so that they can always be happy that they have a son that they can even help always. Yeah.
So, but like, the question is, like, when you make some money in Canada, maybe you save up maybe 10,000 Canadian dollars, and with this money you can go to Ghana, you can open a small business, like you can open a restaurant, you can buy and sell cars, and so like if you would have this opportunity, would you go back to Ghana and live again in Ghana?
Yeah, actually, when I get that kind of opportunity, why not? I'll go back to Ghana. I'll go back to my country to gain further my own business. I'll go back.
Okay. So another question is, since I've been to West Africa, everybody, or even I have been to Ethiopia. Ethiopia was my first country in Africa, and then I've been 3 months in West Africa. And everybody asked me, oh, how can I get to Europe? Of course, everybody wants to get to Europe. You have friends who did it to Europe. Of course, now it's big on the news, like many people from Africa, from the Middle East, they come to Europe. Like, do you have many? And why, of course, you're probably gonna have a lot, but why did you choose this trip, like going to Canada instead of going to Germany, for example? Germany is very easy.
Yeah, actually, I understand you. I understand you. Because people be passing through Libya, crossing through the river to Europe. Like, everybody have his own choice. I just decide myself, and was an opportunity, like I was saying, opportunity come at once. Like, if you have a free visa with a Ecuadorian, like for instance, Ghana and Ecuadorian, they have a free visa. Ghana and Jamaica, they have a free visa. So if you can even take that kind of opportunity, it's better for you to take that opportunity. That's why I just make my own opportunity. Because people, a lot of people be passing through Europe. So I decide myself that I want to be part of the American states so that I can even fed up something from them. Because all of them can even go and stay in the one place. You can choke. So you have to also, you have to think twice so that you can be shipped to another place.
But of course, not everybody from Africa can go to Europe and America and Canada. Like, it's, they are big countries, but of course, like, Africa is very big. So if everybody would leave Africa, there wouldn't be any people left in Africa. And of course, like, the system, they will collapse. And of course, like, the problem is the people that come to Europe. Like, I just can talk for Germany, since I'm a German. They come to Germany and they get welfare from the government, and they are not allowed to work. And then, of course, the more people come, then more expensive it's going to be. And then one day they can say, okay, we stop accepting people. And then, yeah, the people who risk their life, they have to go back. So,
you know, one thing, at times what people travel a lot, at times the violence, at times a lack of work, lack of job. Many people, everybody's have his own story. Everybody's have his own story. Everybody's have his own reason why he left his country. But if somebody just left his country, it doesn't mean that the person will not come back his country again. No. The person will come back his country. But it was going the place that he can even get a better future, so that he can even come and cover for his country. Because when you're in your country, when your country is not developing, when your country is a lack of, like, poverty and those kind of things, you can't sit and also die in poverty. So when you get an opportunity, you can also try your best so that you can even go someplace. When you go someplace, when you get a better future, you can even come and help those who are coming, so that the life will be easy for everybody.
Like you said, you have many, or you know many people who went to Europe. Would you say many people go there because to work, or do many people also go there just to get money from the government and just to have a nice day without working?
Yeah, well, that's what I was saying. People have, everybody have his own things. Because others have been going to Europe to get a work to do, to continue the education, to do something better for their future. Others can even stay forever without coming in his country. But majority of them, they went there to get a better future, to come and help for ones that they are in poverty in home. That's why people be going.
Are you a Christian or Muslim?
No, I'm a Muslim.
You're Muslim. Do you you see, like, many, or do you think, like, Muslim culture is compatible to other cultures? Like, you see, like, now in Europe, you have you've seen, what maybe you heard what happened in Cologne, like that migrants, especially from North Africa. They were touching girls, and there are many rapes going on, and many criminals come over. Of course, it's not everybody is individual. There's always bad people, but yeah. Do you think like Muslim culture is compatible to Christian countries?
No, it's just like, you know, somebody was saying that the appearance is not what they would tell you that this guy is have a how can I say it? is have a beautiful appearance or something like that, but is a heart that can even detect the person that the person is very good. Others are good, others are bad. I cannot say a Muslim, I cannot say a Christian. We are all equal. But it depends how you are and how your lifestyle and how your attitude is. That can even call you as a Muslim or as a Christian.
Okay. As I've been to West Africa, in every big city, I saw like many young men on the streets just looking for opportunities all the time. And of course, even in Africa, because it's very hard to have a job, and then many of them, they turn criminals, like they rob the people, they beat them up, and even kill people. And I think these people are the first, like when they, it's probably all over the news in Africa, that, okay, Merkel invites Africans, and like she invites people coming to Germany. I think these people are the very first going to Europe. What's your opinion on this?
Actually, it's lack of work, lack of job. That is why things been coming like that, because you see a person just completing school without having a job. You see the person starting following a bad friends. After a bad friend, definitely the person who was starting taking people things like in the house, when you put your thing, you will take it. When you put something like this, you will take it. After that, you won't do it at home. You will send it back. You will send it outside so that you will become armed robber and taking people things, raping and those kind of things. This is a lack of job. For instance, if it is Africa, it's just like here or Europe. People will not disturb their self that they are going to somebody's country to go and struggle for their own. They will stay in their country. But because of there is no lack of job, lack of, there's nothing, and the head of the our leaders, they are not organizing anything well for us, because they are always eating it for their pocket. They are not remember those who are very poor, like, let me help those poor, let me help. Maybe somebody is having an intelligent, instead of to help him, they won't help him, because instead of you to help him, you will help his daughter or his nephew.
So what do you think, what has to change in Africa that people would stay there? Of course, you said jobs, but what do you think in general has to change?
Actually, they have to organize. They have to organize. And they help the leaders. The leaders, there's not supposed to be corruption, those things. They have to make everything to build things for the future, and those who have been coming up. Because in country, if there is no job, it's just like an empty barren. Everybody be passing just at the end of the day, they will start robbing those things. But if there is a job in the country, when you graduated school, you get a job for you to do, you get your assets, they will pay you a month. Everybody will never take his gun to somebody's room that you want to rob someone or something like that. No.
So from my point of view, since on my YouTube channel I talk about economics a lot, In West Africa, many people are mad. It's very hard to run a business because you always have to, like, bribe the politics, the politicians. Like for example, when you have a job, they come to you and say, "Oh, you have to pay this tax. You have to pay this tax." So you don't have any certainty. So in my opinion, the most important thing is economic freedom. And what I see in Africa, and for you as well, people always say the politicians they have to do this and this. And I think the most important thing is when the politicians just leave the people alone, when they let them the freedom to run businesses, to make money, then everything will thrive. And that's what I've seen. Like, people, they want to make businesses. And of course, like I've seen Africans, they have many, many ideas, but then they always struggle with the government. And the government, especially like the worst was Liberia. You see people very, very poor, and the people working for the government, they were driving around in fancy SUVs and fancy clothes, and they just steal the money from the people.
Yeah. It's true. Like what you're saying, we are just bleeding for help, for government to help those who have been coming to get a job, to make a freedom in work and those kind of things. That will help Ghana be going higher and higher. Because it's not our decision, it's not our strength that we are just running for the country. We love the country. But because of these circumstances and these problems and this poverty and those things, that make us everybody be running from the country to go and get a better future. So that's why I mean it's better for them to build those kind of opportunity. When the person just completing school, you can even get your work to do and those things. That can even make the Africa be always be improvement, because Africa, we have everything in Africa, but lack of the leaders that making everybody wants to do it for his own. That's why we are always suffering a lot.
Yeah, for me, like, politics is just like a religion. People know, okay, there are elections going on, and all the politicians, they promise everything and they never deliver. They just lie to them. And instead of telling the government, okay, I don't vote, I don't, just leave me alone, like, I don't want to deal with you, people still believe in voting. That's what you see, like, for example, now in America, like, people were like, oh, Trump is gonna bring us a brighter future, and now you see, like, Trump is like bombing Syria, there's like threats going on with North Korea. So people, in my opinion, and that's what I'm talking about a lot on my channel, like, people always believe in government, and instead of just like telling them, okay, just leave us alone and we will we can organize our life alone, like, we don't need anybody.
Yeah, it's true, because before the government came, the government would promise you that you would do this, you would do that. After you vote for the person, where the person just come in power, he will definitely forget you. He was doing for his own. That one is not fair. It's not fair. If that one that we can even vote for you to come and do without doing nothing, if we are there without a government, it's very nice for us, for you to have a government that we can even not getting anything from them, like suffering and those things. Actually, it's not good. It's not good at all. It's not good at all.
In Germany, we just see young men coming. Where are the women? Like, you had a girlfriend back home, or like the friends who are leaving, they have girlfriends and promise them to take them to their country where they arrive? Or what happened to the girls?
In all
Africa, and like, yeah, just men come from Africa, from Middle East. Where are the girls? Why don't the girls leave? And
others haven't girl in their home side, and others doesn't have a girlfriend or a wife in their home side. Others are going out when they get their access. They can't even process for the lady to come to join him where the place where he live. Yeah, others are doing that, and others too, they are just going out to get the money and the future so that they can even vote for the children that he giving birth to them and the families.
One last question, like, you told me, you almost died, like, you saw, like, friends of you dying. You think, and you still haven't arrived to your destination. Now you're in Mexico, and of course you have a job, you can earn money, you survive. It's a better life than in Kumasi. But do you think it's worth taking this risk, like, risking your life?
In Kumasi?
No. Do you think it's worth for this, for like for the, yeah, to have a brighter future, to risk your life, like, because yeah, you almost die.
I know, because even whilst I was coming, I already decide myself, and I already make my mind, because I don't know when opportunity will come, but any place that you reach, that you don't have an option like to continue or something like that, you have to stay in that place, because this is the place that you're supposed to stay. But when you get an opportunity, you can even go ahead. Because someone was saying, if you are dancing, then they are playing some music. If you know that the DJ just changed the music, you have to also change your dance. So that's what it is. So when you are here, if you know that the things doesn't go on for you well, you can also think ahead. If it is, you can move forward, then you move forward. If you can go in the place that can even satisfy your own, then you move on. Yeah.
Okay. So, I think I will send this video to some friends who live in Acapulco. Maybe they need a guy, maybe to cook or clean or like looking after the house of as a driver. Maybe I can help you to find a nice job in Mexico, but then you have to learn Spanish. You want to learn Spanish?
Yeah, for that one is very important. Like I was saying to my brother, we are very seriously to learn the Spanish, but because of always thinking and those things, because of thinking about the documents, how you can even process to get the documents, it make us thinking a lot, so you can't even get a satisfied or this thing, fresh of mind to understand the language, because definitely when you say, you definitely understand what you mean, but for you to reply the person is really very difficult. But as time is going on, since we are in Mexico, everything will be okay for us, because we want a better future. If you get a better work here in Mexico, definitely we will stay here in Mexico for through our life.
Yeah, like you've seen today, it's raining. Like, imagine like this being in Canada every day, just raining all the time. It's freezing, and maybe you turn white like me.
actually, it's true. it's true. But you know, we was thinking that Canada is the place that they have a lot of work. That's why we are always thinking ourselves that you're supposed to go there. That's why we are always thinking ourselves. Because here they have a work, but the work there they have is just limping and this kind of working, this kind of assets. And the money that you can even get, you can't even feed for your own, and paying rent for the same time to send to your family is very difficult. That's the reason why that we are thinking a lot. If for your own, we don't have any problem. But always we are thinking back where we come from.
Another question, another last question. So how you send the money back home? Probably with Western Union, right? When you have money?
Yeah, we are sending through Western Union.
Okay. Have you heard about Bitcoin?
Bitcoin? Yeah, I hear about it, but I never following those kind of things before. Yeah,
Bitcoin is the new currency. It's digital currency, and you can, especially like for Africa, it's very nice. Like you can send money from everywhere in the world. Like you can send it from Mexico to everywhere in the world for very little money. Like for example, 500 American dollars. You just pay like 50 cents to send it to Ghana, and then in Ghana, the people, when they receive it, they just have to translate it to Ghana money again, and then they have the money. So it's like, it's very convenient, and many people, like just saw a video yesterday, like Philippines, many people live abroad, and for this for these people working abroad, sending money back home, it's perfect, because Western Union charges like 10-15% on charges. So maybe when you will become rich, do your research on Bitcoin and send.
It will be very easy for us to build this kind of, because whilst things is going on, technology is coming up and those things. So it's very good. It's very good to hear that we can even follow you in those kind of things, so that everything will be easy for us without disturbing your mind, going, wasting, you know, taking some line, those things is very terrible. Yeah.
And I've seen it actually in, where was it? I think like all over Africa, they have like systems with where you can send money via SMS, or like you just send a text message and then you can send money. I think you got stuff like this in Ghana as well, right?
Yeah, in Africa we have it called mobile money and those things. Yeah, we have it. But the problem is that here in Mexico, you can't even send money from here to Ghana. Now we are finding it difficult, or less from States American to Ghana.
So Bitcoin is like international mobile money. It's very easy, it's very widespread. And actually I started to buy Bitcoin in 2015 the first time, and I like, there was one Bitcoin was the price of 200 euros, and now it's 1,100 euros. So the price went up. So when you put it aside, maybe when you buy 10 bitcoins, you can make a lot of money. So it's even like it always goes up in value, not like government money, because like the money is always run by the government, and they always print more and more, and you have high inflation, and then prices go up, and it's like cheating the people.
actually, it's nice. So we definitely put ourselves in that kind of things.
Just watch my channel, you will find some English interviews you can watch. Yeah. Okay, Suleiman, thank you very much for the interview, and I wish you good luck for your future. Hopefully you will find a good job, maybe in Mexico, maybe in Canada. So good luck. Thank you very much.
Thank you a lot. Nice to meet you.